You're listening to the Capitol Press Room, and we're turning our attention to a new state pilot program intended to help pay for the cost of medication utilized to treat opioid use disorder. And our guest is Dr. Chinazo Cunningham, the 1990 Big Ten softball batting champion and commissioner for the State Office of Addiction Services and Supports. Welcome back to the show, Doctor.
Thank you, David.
So what was the impetus behind this pilot program, which is designed to help New Yorkers with the cost of buprenorphine?
You know, one of our main goals is to make sure that we expand evidence-based treatment. And buprenorphine is one of three medications that are approved for the treatment of opioid use disorder. And we know that it's really effective. It's life-saving. It actually reduces the risk of overdose death by 50%. So we're really trying to think about reducing barriers to access to this medication. And we know that cost can be one of the barriers. And so, you know, this is an important program that will basically pay for the medication so that people do not have any out-of-pocket cost.
You mentioned potential barriers. Is it your understanding that people, what, go for a prescription of this? And when they're told about the cost, they end up not getting it. People don't pursue it to begin with because they expect there's an expectation of cost. How does cost serve as a barrier?
Yeah, well, you know, like many other types of medical treatment, there are multiple different kinds of barriers. And so we have a lot of initiatives to try and address multiple different barriers. And so this one specifically is addressing cost issues. And so for people who don't have insurance, or for people who are underinsured, this is really trying to address those barriers. And so, you know, the medication can be expensive. It can run up to $300 a month for people without insurance. And so the state will pay for that to make sure that, you know, people have life-saving treatment. So we're working with our programs and then also programs that are overseen by the Department of Health as well, that really reach people who are using drugs and who have an opioid use disorder.
Are there other outreach efforts that you will embark on, aside from talking to influential radio hosts, to ensure that people are aware of this subsidy? Should we expect, say, an ad campaign or something like that?
You know, we have, you know, a sort of multi-pronged approach to really trying to improve access to buprenorphine treatment and just medication treatment in general. And so, you know, we just also announced a new initiative to fund programs to provide low threshold buprenorphine. And what that looks like is that people can get medication on the same day that they present for treatment, that the programs are going out into the communities and doing outreach outside the walls of their clinics to really reach people who are most marginalized. And so we're about to announce those programs that will be supported, and that's up to $7.5 million. And then we're also investing in, you know, telehealth so that people can access buprenorphine through telehealth services as well. So there's really kind of a variety of ways that we're trying to address the barriers. And so this program is the one that really focuses on cost, but other ones focus on some of the other, you know, geographic barriers or just barriers, you know, waiting for people to come to us versus going out and actually meeting people where they are.
And is there a reason why this program is targeting buprenorphine specifically? Because I believe you said this is one of three medications that could be used to combat opioid use disorder.
Yeah, so the three medications are buprenorphine, methadone, and naltrexone. And so buprenorphine and methadone are used the vast majority of time. And methadone, because of really stringent federal regulations, is a really a different approach. So people don't get methadone at a pharmacy. They have to go to an opioid treatment program to get treatment with methadone. And, you know, so that's kind of a parallel system. But certainly that is something that we'll also have many initiatives to really expand access to methadone treatment as well. But so at the pharmacy level, it's really buprenorphine that's available. And so, you know, we want to make sure that we're meeting the needs of everybody and that based on the individual person's need, we can match the kind of treatment that they need.
This is billed as a pilot program. Does that mean it could be expanded in the future, or is the pilot nomenclature just a reference to maybe the temporary nature of the program?
So this is brand new. And so we are in the process of piloting it. And, you know, our plan is to definitely expand as we get more experience. So right now we have 9 programs, 5 that are in the specialty drug treatment program under OASIS and 4 that are under the Department of Health. So when patients come to these programs, they then can access the service, but we are working across the state to get more and more providers enrolled. And ultimately, we have $15 million available for this program. And so that will be available over several years. So this is new, and we're working to continue to expand access.
Well, for listeners just joining us, you're listening to the Capitol Press Room, and our guest is Dr. Chinazo Cunningham, Commissioner for the State Office of Addiction Services and Supports. And we're talking about a new state pilot program intended to help pay for the cost of medication utilized to treat opioid use disorder. So why does the state have a vested interest in providing this type of subsidy?
We know that we're at the worst point ever in terms of the overdose epidemic. So more people are dying than ever before in New York State. In terms of the preliminary numbers from 2021, over 6,000 people in New York died of overdose. And that's one person almost every 2 hours. So, you know, we have to do something about that. It's a huge, you know, crisis. And we're really thinking out of the box to try and really improve access to evidence-based strategies that we know will help save lives. And so this is one key part of that.
And where does the money come from? I think you mentioned $15 million over multiple years. Where is that funding from?
So there's a source of money, we call it the Opioid Stewardship Fund, that comes from an opioid tax that was put into effect a few years ago. And so this tax is really on top of the opioids that people are prescribed across the state. And this was put into place by law. And so from that, these dollars are then used to really address addiction in many different ways. And using this for, again, evidence-based treatment and really promoting harm reduction are some of the key areas in how we're using these dollars.
Is it possible that moving forward, because of, I say, the limited scope of that opioid tax, you might end up tapping into, say, opioid settlement funds to invest in something like this?
Yeah, so the opioid settlement funds are you know, certainly a different revenue. And those funds come from the litigation against pharmaceutical companies and pharmaceutical distributing companies. And so through the opioid settlement funds, we're working with our opioid settlement fund advisory board and their recommendations. And so I think, you know, their recommendations are similar in terms of really supporting harm reduction efforts, so reducing barriers, and then also expanding evidence-based treatment. So those are some of the top priorities of the Opioid Settlement Fund Advisory Board. So this is really in line with those recommendations. And this is a priority for us at OASIS, is to really reduce barriers, embrace harm reduction, expand evidence-based approaches, and really have equitable distribution of services. And so I think the equity piece is also really important here so that there are not barriers based on cost and income.
Well, speaking of barriers, do you feel like the drug itself, buprenorphine, is accessible enough? I mean, are there enough prescribers out there who are writing scripts for this, who are available to people who are looking to address opioid use disorder?
So that's a great question, David. And I would say, no, there are not enough. And this is what I have spent much of my career as a physician really promoting, is for more and more doctors, primary care doctors, emergency room doctors, to really provide buprenorphine treatment. I mean, we can't just rely on specialists in addiction because there's just not enough, but we need it to really be spread across all healthcare. And one really important change that's recent is that previously, in order to prescribe buprenorphine, healthcare providers had to do an either 8-hour or 24-hour training. They had to sign up with the DEA to get a special waiver to prescribe buprenorphine. But just in the last several months, that has been changed and that requirement is no longer. And so now any medical provider who prescribes controlled substances can prescribe buprenorphine. And so that's really important. So that gives us a real opportunity to really expand access to buprenorphine treatment. So we'll see sort of what that does in terms of the landscape, but we're certainly hopeful that more and more people will be prescribing. And then we need to make sure that we're providing the support on the end of the patient so that people can access that.
Is there a cultural barrier that you need to overcome as well with doctors, even if they are able to prescribe buprenorphine? Do you feel like enough doctors are comfortable or willing to prescribe it?
Yeah, that's a great question. And so I would say there's a ton of stigma around addiction, period. And then there's also stigma around the treatment for addiction, including buprenorphine and methadone. And that stigma has been present for decades in this country. So we do have to address that. And, you know, healthcare providers, like other people in the lay public, you know, have grown up with a lot of the messages in this country that are really stigmatizing. So they have stigmatizing views of people who use drugs as well. So that is something that we have to address head on. You know, I am hopeful that I think that certainly the younger generation of medical providers have grown up in the era of opioids and, you know, the overdose epidemic and recognize the need to really address addiction as part of their job. And so I think that is, you know, very hopeful in that we're seeing more and more young people who are recently completing their training taking on prescribing buprenorphine and addressing addiction.
Thinking of that issue of being hopeful, you've got about a year and a half under your belt now as commissioner at Oasis. Do you feel hopeful about combating the opioid epidemic?
Definitely. We are at the worst point ever in terms of the overdose epidemic. But, you know, what I would say is there's a real investment in addressing addiction, and that investment is certainly embraced by Governor Hochul. And also, we see it at the federal government level as well. And so we have all these resources now to really expand the delivering of services. I think the other thing is, I think people are willing now to sort of rethink the old ways in which we've been addressing addiction. And I think more and more people are embracing harm reduction. We see this again at the federal government, and this is, you know, a priority of ours at Oasis. And harm reduction is really about focusing on reducing the harms associated with substance use. It may include abstinence, but it's not only about abstinence. And the focus is really to keep people alive. And so that shift kind of in the paradigm is very hopeful. And, you know, we're seeing it sort of at all levels.
Well, we've been speaking with Dr. Chinazo Cunningham. She's the commissioner for the State Office of Addiction Services and Supports. Dr. Cunningham, thank you so much for making the time.
Thank you so much, David.
And for more Capital Press Room content, visit capitalpressroom.org or wherever you download your favorite podcasts. And if you listen to us from an Apple device, make sure to leave us a rating and a review so it helps other people find the show.
Support for the Capitol Press Room provided by the New York State AFL-CIO, a federation of 3,000 unions fighting for working people by keeping New York State union strong. Visit unionstrongny.org for more information. Join us again for Capitol Press Room, a production of WCNY Connected, Syracuse.